From the pitch to the podium, your all-access pass to the world of sport is right here. Marawa Sports Worldwide on 947. Vuma FM. And Rise FM. Powered by Hollywood Bets.
These kinds of explosions that you expect only to happen when you're down in Durban, Ethekwini, Ekakasini, because that's exactly where we find ourselves as Marawa Sports Worldwide today. Great to have everybody on board. And I played that deliberately because typically on a Wednesday, we normally dub it Wednesday nights or soccer nights. But today, it's going to take a little bit of a complete twist and a shift and a change. And we do it deliberately. I'll tell you why. Because the next guest that we have on the show today, it's huge, guys. I mean, huge in every aspect that you may think of. I mean, his name, synonymous with blistering pace. You talk about electric footwork. You talk about try-scoring brilliance. I mean, this man is a beacon of hope and inspiration for many, many people. His journey from the humble beginnings, in the rural village in the Eastern Cape, to the pinnacle of world rugby. This is a testament now to his unwavering determination and exceptional talent. He was born just the other day, man. I don't know why people are saying that he's getting old. He was just born, 1990. His childhood was a world away from the glamour of professional rugby. Basically, a typical childhood rooted in what they call rural simplicity. Like a lot of us. Growing up in a poor, remote village, I mean, he lacked the luxuries that most of these young athletes take for granted. And rugby wasn't just a sport. It was a source of joy. It was a source of escape. Played on dusty fields with makeshift balls. I mean, you know, these little plastic ones that we all put together and we pretend that they're the real thing. Now, despite these limitations, his natural talent shone through. With his raw speed, you talk about agility, pretty evident from a young age. His exceptional pace and finishing ability not only propelled the Springboks to victory, but also cemented his place as a world-class winger. I think they call him D-Rex. Hey, I don't know. He'll tell me about it. I mean, this story, guys, I mean, it transcends the realm of sports. It serves as a role model to young athletes, particularly those from disadvantaged backgrounds. And his journey, though, from those rural fields in the pinnacle of rugby demonstrates that with a dedication, a lot of hard work, unwavering belief that anything is possible. But the one thing that for me has always shone and stood out is his humility and commitment to the community, further solidifying his status as an inspirational figure. And argue with me any day, you're not going to win this argument. I mean, he remains one of the humblest people ever. I'm not even going to talk about the other parts where I just put out a poster saying that he'll be on the show today. Yay! Kosiam, let's leave it there. Ladies and gentlemen, makazole mapimpis, yeah? Whew. I don't know what I left out, man. Good to see you, Baba. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much, Rob. I think you've been trying to reach me out, yeah, I think, for years now.
Yeah.
It's my first time in the studio.
And
this way, you're an engineer. Yeah, but yeah, man, thanks for the opportunity as well to speak to you. And I think you're one of the people that I look up into, I think, back in the days and watching soccer.
Yes.
I used to play soccer though.
Wow. What happened?
We used to in my village, I think Eastern Cape though.
Yeah.
Time Bushbucks was there. And of course it's we don't have like facilities, all of this stuff, you know. I think every people in rural areas do play soccer. And I was quite good the kickboard side even now.
Oh.
And yeah, I mean, I think I did gain weight, and we didn't have a soccer pick at school. So, and then I decided, you know what, let me just focus on rugby.
Sure. So, Bafana could have had a Makazole Mapimpi. Because you're saying you were good and you were using both your feet.
Yeah, probably better than rugby. Because I used to kick for border,
yes,
in terms of poles, club rugby. and actually kick both sides. So it could be, but it depends with where I was gonna go at the same time. But I was too far from the system as like a rugby stuff, you know.
Yeah.
But I'm glad that they decided to just go on a rugby.
Well, I mean, it's paid off, and I was going to ask you, it's paid off handsomely for you, and I'm glad though, because you're such a talented person, you're such an outstanding rugby player, you're such a great ambassador of people that believe in believing. You have turned rugby on its head, where many people did not even think you had a chance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you move from a franchise where they say, hey, yeah, they bankrupt, now we can't carry on, and yet you come to a province now that has welcomed you with very warm arms for many, many years.
Yeah.
How would you, in a short phrase, Makozoda, describe your journey? I mean, when you sit now here, you are today, 28th of October, 2024.
Yeah.
What goes through your mind in terms of your journey?
Well, the first thing, I think it's something that I did enjoy.
Yeah.
At the same time, there was no pressure, so I didn't have something to lose, because I was kind of trying my best. And also I think something that did help me, I was just pushing, just because of I was more hungry, and the only thing I wanted to do just to survive. And officially I didn't care about a lot of things that what's going on. I think my first contract with Border, I did have like decent amount.
Yes.
And from back there, I think my life changed, because I saw the opportunity. I was like, I think there's something that I can surely eat with this.
Yeah.
One of my friend, he passed away, Billy.
Mm-hmm.
We from same rural areas. We used to go to school, struggle back at home, but he was in a better position because he had good family that did always help him. And he was just honest with me. He said another day, I was back in the days in rural areas, said, I think you can get paid by playing rugby. It's tricky when someone from the outside, or a friend, or someone who's watching, can actually see your talent more than you and believe in you. And I was kind of shocked, and it was kind of like a chat. We just finished playing rugby at the time, because the way I look at that time, I was like, ah, man, you're joking. Because of the belief that I had that time was, I'm far from the system. There's no chance that there's actually someone back at home can actually say, you know what, I will sacrifice from that guy, I will take it out, and then I'll put that guy somewhere around township or something like that, you know. So fast forward, going up there and then meeting people still, they said, hey, you can be a Springbok, you know, still, you know. And funny thing, that time when I go different places at the same time, it's kind of like, I think English, it kind of hold me back.
Express yourself and so on.
To understand. Yeah, yeah. So I was kind of, I mean, I think in life it's general that everyone has got something that actually can hold you back in terms of be out there expressing yourself to people. So I was kind of like, even if I go with white people, how I'm going to talk, how I'm going to do things, because rugby is more about communication.
Yeah. Because, and that's such an important point though, because I think also, and you mentioned it, you said, you know, been trying to get hold of an interview with you, and a lot of the times would be like, no, hey, Makozoda doesn't like to be out there in the media. And that I understand. I understand fully. And that is why there's never pressure to do that. But I can almost bear in my mind then, if it is your teammates that you're thinking, my goodness, if I'm not speaking this English, if I'm not speaking maybe some of the Afrikaans as well, maybe I'm going to be seen as an outcast.
Yeah.
Not putting in your mind that actually this is not a linguistic competition. You are here to play rugby.
Yes.
As long as you can do the basics of rugby or more,
yes,
then you're winning. So when did that change? When did that mentality for you change to say, you know what, language or whatever aside, I'm focusing on my God-given talent?
It's it's challenging sometimes, because you don't have people that to mingle with, more especially when you're rich. Because I play under 19.
Yeah.
Differently, it's most of the guys from private school that they are on the under 19 side, and also with the white guys at the same time. Mm-hmm. You know, me being that position, I couldn't function proper because I'm not myself.
Yes.
Even if I see things, I can't actually raise up, okay, listen, can you do this? Can you do this like this, like this? So sometimes you find yourself like you isolated, because everyone has something to talk in the corner. There's nothing wrong with that, because of it's just like general that you're gonna find someone, probably the guy that used to like go to school with someone and say, hey, I saw you used to play like this. Yes. Oh, Trevor Nick, all of the stuff, Derby, Selborne, Queens, all of the stuff, you know. I don't have a chat around there, you know. But the belief, it just grows that actually I need to understand myself before anything. And it's more everyone from rural areas we can speak, because I had friends that I used to play in high school from Cholong. They went to Dale.
Yeah.
And those guys who was there with me, they couldn't speak English, the same thing, but they're talented like me. And so it's the same thing, because we come from rural areas, we can actually go to private school, but it depends with your family.
Mm.
How big is your family? They can actually take care of yourself, all of this stuff, sacrificing things to take your kids to private school so your kids cannot get stuck when you're meeting people. Mm. Because the young kids meeting white people first time, you get shocked because you don't know what you're gonna say. How are you good, and then it just goes down there, because you don't know what's next, all of this stuff. So they believe, it's just stated there that, you know what, actually I'm gooder than those guys. That's the only thing that I can actually say, if I can actually put like extra work to make sure probably the coaches can see me better. Someone who knows rugby can find the talent, someone can be with me, actually show me different things. I think I've been with Border for, I think, 3 years, but I struggled to be with the Border because I was 2011. I was always invited there, holding bags, but I don't get the contract.
Sure.
And so me being that system most of the time, because club rugby that I was playing, I was kind of over the club rugby. So the border coach used to come watch us, one of my friend Michael, in the club rugby, just to go watch us, but we don't get the cash, we don't get all of the stuff. So that belief, it did build me differently. And also I think timing, man. That's one of the things that I just like, you know what? I think it's a good timing for me, because I was kind of growing every single year.
Yeah.
Try to talk. It doesn't matter the English that I'm trying to talk, but someone else can actually try to just fix me there. Yeah. I don't know, it's this name or this way, it's all of the stuff, you know? It was tough. Funny story, one of the day we had like one-on-one chat with the coaches, every single player, border, my first time. I couldn't sleep, man. My one-on-one is coming tomorrow, probably 11 o'clock. We always have like different type of 30 minutes or 20 minutes. Jeez, when I look at this schedule, 30 minutes, it's long. It's way longer.
So something's going through your mind. No, and,
I couldn't sleep.
Yeah.
I couldn't. Like the following day, I go, and then I told one of the guys, I go, I said, I think I'm going to struggle, man, to talk there. Can you come with me? Just like kind of explain everything, translate. One of my friend, Ubik, he said, I don't want anyone there. I want you to go. I want you just to listen. And then come back. He went to Cambridge School, which is one of the schools as well in this London. I want you just to go there and then listen. Just build your confidence, man. I went there and good thing, because the coach, he just kind of understand me, where I'm coming from, all of this stuff. And he just speaks about what I can improve, what I can do at the same time. And I think the time I walk out there, and then it was more about, geez, I think I need to do something better about this English thing. Funny enough as well, in the team meeting, you know, coach is throwing questions, you know, about probably clips, what we can do better, what we can cover. You need to speak. So the question comes to me, and I can't speak. And then I was like, yeah. And then he started getting upset, and then he just said that, I think, in front of everyone, I think it's time now to go read the books, watch, like, probably episode, all of the stuff, but in the English stuff, you know. I couldn't take it, because I thought this one is just making funny of me in front of people, you know. That's where I started realizing that I think it's a good thing, because he said one day you're going to be a man of the match in front of the camera. You need to speak English. You know? That's where it just, I pick up everything there. I was like, ah, that's true.
Sure.
2 years later, boom, man of the match.
And you had to speak that English.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I told you, remarkable story. And and you're right, you know, sometimes when people want to make fun of you, and I'll ask you this as I head to the break, because I know you love your football, and one of the greatest football players of his era, he's still playing right now, his name is Lionel Messi. You know him, right? You know him, right?
Yeah, I do.
Have you ever heard Lionel Messi speak English?
No.
MSW Mara Sports Worldwide, coming through from our Durban studios. Makazole Mabimbi is my guest today. A man who went through a great difficulty, as he described before the break, on many different fronts. But look at him now. And also today, I'll tell you why today was such an important day, such a significant day for him. Because again, you know, as the Mabimbi star continues to shine, a lot of things also continue to come around and work out and fall into place. And today was more than a beautiful day today, because you brought the entire headquarters of Hollywood Beds to a standstill, because you are being now inducted as the latest ambassador of many ambassadors who've achieved a great deal in South Africa. What is that feeling like? How did this whole deal come about? And firstly, congratulations.
Thank you. Yeah, first of all, I'm grateful, and I always say to people, as long as you wake up, you walk, you can talk with people, and you must remind yourself as you're grateful. And there's a lot of people that they can't have that at all. And without things, what do you want to achieve, all of this stuff? No, I think that's a very important thing. And yeah, to be part of the Hollywood Beds family, it's amazing for me, and I'm also like proud of myself as well, and very happy to be to work with them. And it's, I think it's something that started from, I think earlier this year, we had the like a school donation back at home, Danzan as well, where I'm coming from. And it's one of the things that I wanted to do, probably during my career, but it's always tricky to control a foundation during your career, because you have your career, which is something that I never step away, because I always say that I think my career comes first with anything. Probably that's why I'm here, but I'm not being arrogant about that. I think it's very important for everyone that, we did a campaign, which is a uniform, school shoes, I beg at home. And I think where the friendship started with Hollywood, and I mean, they're one of the people that have been working across the world, and most especially in South Africa. And the time I was in Eastern Cape, I always see the cars. I always saw like Kaunda going back to Eastern Cape, giving away tackle bags, the cones, the ball, all of the stuff. But fast forward for everything, see myself sitting in a chair talking about that, that I'm in the position that's now, actually it's not only about me, it's more about what I'm gonna do for the community. I think that's one of the things that is very important. Taking back, starting down with the foundation, how the foundation started. Back at home, I used to go to school. Probably most of the people know the story. Go to school without the shoes, playing a rugby without the boots, all of the stuff. There was one of the guys who used to work in Cape Town, which is kind of like a water boy thing. So when you're a water boy, as I know now, because I didn't know back then, you kind of like communicate with the players, you know, make sure you can ask the old kids, the boots, all of the stuff, because of we different people probably wear boots like 4 times, 5 times, and then they throw it to the bin, all of the stuff. So I used to take those boots, old boots, supplement, socks, shorts, bring us. Then we wear that, you know, and I was one of the guys that received the boots from that guy, and because of what I was doing, which is playing rugby. And I think me seeing those kindness from people, umdu abandu, and I never take it far at that time. I was like, oh, I'm special, which is I was more special around, bragging around my friends that I have a boots, Adidas boots, all of the stuff, you know. But as I grow up, starting realizing things that now, man, I think that thing was big. And the opportunity that I have now using my name, not only eating by myself, I think is very important for me that I can look actually back, do what I can, because I cannot help everyone here in South Africa, but helping probably 4 or 5 guys that they can actually achieve something because of under my name, I think it can actually be good. Actually, if people, I don't want to take 2 people too much because it's what I'm doing is coming from my heart and also with different. But if you can actually everyone do that to everyone back at home or everyone that actually you know that you can actually assist there. Most people do that, which is good. Mm-hmm. So yeah, from now, it's something that the foundation way started right now. And then I've been doing that, you know, but I don't do stuff for social media, especially when I took back boots, old boots to my community.
Or with cameras boots, that everybody must see you.
It's not for
it's
my
a personal
heart.
Thing.
Yes, it's personal that because I was in that position. No one took the pictures for me doing that at the same time. But it becomes different now when the brands coming around now. Now it needs to be public now because I'm working with brands. People need to understand that. Of which if it was money for me, I would do that under the ground. Not people knowing that because I'm doing that for myself and also it's coming from my heart. But now it's more like the brands coming in now. Also they need to see the work that I'm doing.
But when did you realize though, because in your humility, when did you realize that Makazola Mapimpi was just not a rugby player? He was now a walking brand that people wanted to associate with you. People wanted to align with you. People wanted to use you as a marketing tool. People wanted, you know, you can use different words.
Yeah.
But when did that light shine within you to say, you know what, hey, rugby has carried me this far, but now I'm a walking brand?
I think the foundation thing is started from as like a chat with people, friends, all of the stuff, you know, and most of us, probably me, I don't actually really know what I can do to use my name at the same time. As I said to you, my focus was more about playing rugby and then get money so I can take care of myself. But meeting friends and then having a chat about things, as I said as well, that I did stuff, but I was doing under
yes.
the ground at the same time. But I met one of my friend, which is after World Cup,
yeah.
Umbas from East London. He was working here in Durban. He went to Hudson, right? He went to Hudson. So we used to play rugby, although he went to Hudson in Windrose, you know.
Oh.
And then we had the chat about everything. And then I think I did receive like an email thing from one of people just want to work with me.
Mm.
And then I was like, you know what? I don't want to get stuck too much. This guy knows how to work. And then he did study all of the stuff. Let me just go to him and then sit down and then talk about it. And then I show him the email, and then he said, I think you need to find someone. I think you more than anything, you know. But that time, even the after World Cup thing, I was just enjoying myself that time because it's all about me.
Yeah.
I don't care about anything, what's going on. And it just, I'm always honest to myself.
Yeah.
And also he knows that I'm always honest. And also I'm always honest to someone that I'm having a chat with. You like it, you don't like it. You're going to walk away. If you want to hear truth, if you don't want, I'm not going to associate with me. He just introduced me with Siba, which is my manager now. That she's doing PR stuff, that she can actually help me on that, you know. Still, English that time, it's not popping. They come try and find like different things that we need to do, videos, we need to market, you know, I need to do interviews. Now it's going straight to the TV thing now.
Back to the things you hate.
I said, yeah, guys, I'm not comfortable to do this thing, you know. No, you have to. You have to do this thing, all of this stuff. So like, it was like TV shows in the morning, you know, later, radio station, all of
makeup,
this stuff.
Makeup, you know, you must look, you know.
All of this stuff, powder, you know, man. I need to do this. Oh. Always sweating how I'm gonna start, I'm gonna do this. It's my first time doing that time, you know. But it's the coolest thing about we 100%. Do grow up and we see Zindas and the guy outside there, and we achieve things also. We understand how things work. The more you meet people, the more you have a chat with people, and having mindset of kindness is here in my mind. It's always something's always there because I know someone and I don't take that for granted because of I was nothing,
yeah,
you know. And I try to find myself, and there's people try to build me until here, you know.
Because now, Magazole, there's life after rugby. And I see also a lot of the voice notes that are coming through. People are starting to ask about that because, I mean, I don't know. Maybe you still want to play until you are 40 years old. Who knows? You have it within you to do that, hey?
Evening, Mr. Marawa. Evening to Umakazole, my pimpy. Hey, Mr. Marawa. I have a three-year-old who loves this guy. Ubekelela irapi just for umampimpi no kolis. Ufuna uthelo. Iti hi thalo boy.
Hello, hello, umampimpi.
Great show as always, Star Rob. Thank you.
Short.
Oh man, talk about snatching a person's heart. Hey, what are you doing to the kids, Babimpi?
Crazy. Yeah.
Wow.
Yo, I don't know. I don't even understand sometimes, you know.
Okay, let's give you a moment. Let's give you a moment. Sure.
Hashtag MSW. Hashtag MSW.
All right, 15 minutes to go before the top of the hour. It is hashtag MSW. Marawa Sports Worldwide chatting to Springbok legend. I know he hasn't retired, but we can fondly call him that by now, because I don't think too many people are going to achieve what he's achieved so far. If they want to, as he says, they're more than willing to chase what he has led. Hey, heading into the break, there was that very touching call where a three-year-old, I think for the very first time, must be the youngest caller on the show ever, who declared their love for you, your appreciation for you.
Mm.
I think in a moment that got everybody here in studio, yeah, almost teary, and I'm sure people that are listening on the radio as well. How do you respond to such love that is given to you, even by the most innocent of souls?
Yeah, you. I think it hits different because it's a true love, and being in this situation, almost the country, the love they, that they give me, it just replaces like everything. And I've been saying this about my background, but it's my journey, and it's a reality. So whatever that's going on, you just touch back where I'm coming from, and the love that I receive from the kids, from old people, elders, it's always hit different. And it's just, there's something, it's just a value, because when I track back, actually it can be a trauma from someone, and it can be something that you can actually be with you the rest of your life, which is talking about the love that you're talking about. I never received that love under the condition that I lost my mom early in the age. So tracking back what's my sister as well, she was the next. I never spent time with my brother, and it was kind of like around me cousin at the same time, you know. But receiving a love from your blood is hit different with anything. And because someone that actually try to be there for you, I never have that. And experiencing that, actually that thing can take me somewhere with someone that I can be with, because I don't know probably how to love someone, because it was always like about I'm alone.
Yeah.
I'm trying just to survive so I can go somewhere. No one is actually behind me and say, I'm with you.
Mm.
Hey, did you eat? No, I didn't eat. Okay, cool. I can send 100 rand. Oh, I can do that. That thing can actually be with someone's life forever, because you don't know what to love. And you never felt to be loved in your family. So giving back that love, because you was always everything about you. You don't care about someone else, you know. Me having those people that actually see the love, it's kind of like a real, because I can actually see the love. This is raw.
Yes.
It's from the heart. That's the only thing that I want. I don't really care about what you do, you know, because all good things come to the end, you know. But having someone that actually appreciates you giving your love, you can actually remember that person anytime because of that person was there for you from the heart. So there's a lot of things that can actually touch me. You know, I'm not saying that because there's someone can say that, I used to grow up with my grand as well, you know, but the condition of the love that I used to receive that time was more about, hey, Dakshaya, all of the stuff, I will do this, all of the stuff, you know. But that love told me another way how to do things, because I was kind of like, okay, I need to be strong. I need to do this thing. It's funny enough because in my village, people used to beat me.
And gentlemen.
It's just like, not in a bad way. Yeah. Like, these are unclone as close. Mm-hmm. Like, a zoom fire, you need to get head somewhere. I try to sell a sweet,
yeah,
a cigarette as well, because of the pressure that I had that back at home,
yeah,
at the same time. Funny enough, people used to take advantage of me because I don't have a brother. I don't know if anyone can stand for me.
Anyone to protect you?
Protect me.
Yeah.
Even someone did something. So when I saw like cigarette, like old people, old guys come to me, probably have probably the jacket. They kind of put the jacket on my face, hold me, and then take cigarette in my pocket, probably 10 or 5, all of this stuff, you know. And then I just try, you know. It was so hurt, man, in a bad way, you know. And I go home, you know, and my grand, she can't do anything, you know, and my cousin as well, still she can't do anything. And I just try and then go home, you know. And later on in the stage, you just open about it. I think that's it's everything started by rugby, the way I started playing rugby, because I played rugby in the early stage. I think I was 14 years, I played first team, club rugby. That's where now I opened things for myself, you know. And even if my uncle used to like kind of try to hate me because of the name of my pimpy, which is, he wasn't, the surname wasn't my pimpy, was another surname, but yeah, it's the same name here. But the original surname, it's my pimpy. So his father is my pimpy, you know. But he goes to another way. But another way still, he told me another thing, that because he was fighting for that name. And when I track it back right now, it's kind of like, that was a reason. Because of the same name now is huge, is bigger. And he's got, I think he get that love that he wants to just show as like,
that's what I'm going to say, but it's a mixture of bullying.
Yeah.
It's a mixture of jealousy. It's a mixture of so many different things though.
But I do understand now at the same time. Because of that, you know. And when I look back, I'm living now with Nklalane and a cousin, Zam, which is a banana bag. And you're a man. And Domfazwak, his wife, still alive. And the love that I like, the way they love me, it's, I think it just replaced everything. They're not working, they're back at home. One of my cousins, they tried to work there, two guys. One guy's in PE. They tried to work there, back and there, but I'm kind of very proud and enjoying myself with them. So to summarize that, the rugby just opens everything, that I become a little bit of a star in the village, and people love rugby in the village. If you don't play rugby, become like, yo, I know you like a stubborn thing, you know. So sorry to use that, but it was just, it's such a true thing. People used to do it a long way in from.
No, 100%. And you got to explain it that way, because sometimes when people look down, let's say on gay or LGBTQ, but I understand what you're saying. Yeah, but I'm just trying to put it into context, is that they would almost say you are
it's weak. Raw. It's raw in rural areas. Yeah, yeah. People speak straight like
they,
that.
They say it's straight.
You like it, you don't like it.
That's why you know how it is. Yeah.
I know.
But in all of that, and I think you've summarized a lot of the what Tutebogo was asking about, you not having gone to a private school, but achieving more than a lot of the kids that had the privilege of playing rugby at private schools, or even going to Craven Week, etc. I think you've summarized that, because in a way, and you see now why we've wanted to chat to you. Now we're going to need another show where we talk about the rugby. Where we talk about rugby. Now we've laid the foundation of an open from the heart
I can't give away because I might be doing like a book thing or documentary.
Oh, this is going to help the book. The book is, this is where the book starts. It's so much that's happening here today, but I think it's happening because you deserve what is going on. We've only got a minute left of the show. Unable to talk about the injuries, what you felt like, you know, having to be sidelined and, you know, things that were cracked there. And all over the place. Outbound tour that's coming up and so on. There's a lot of rugby that I've deliberately not wanted to touch on because I thought it's also important for you to open up to the people that you've not been able to speak to. The people that don't know from little sound bites that you talk here and there. You. I didn't even touch on Rassie Erasmus. Mm-hmm. And I know how important he is to your journey. He has told me about you and how important you have been in his journey.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Mm. So, hence I'm saying that this book, we're going to talk about it at some point. But we will, we'll do something special. But just to summarize though, out of everything and anything, the next step, the next phase, you're in good health, you're in good shape. Mm. What does Makazole Mapimpi do from now?
Now it's. I think the journey still to continue, and I think I was probably 32, couple of years, and I think things. Things change now. Like back in the days, people used to retire when they're 32, 33, 31, and also I think it's different for me as well. Because of I'm playing wing, so it's they need pace on the outside at the same time, you know. And I just like still dreadful to be like age of 34, but I'm still part of the Springbok. I don't think there's a few people who can actually reach that at the same time.
Give me a yes or a no, because I've got to go. The next Rugby World Cup. Are you there?
Nah.
No.
Nah.
100%.
100%.
By choice.
Understanding the dynamic of rugby. There's like a lot of
competition.
Yeah, competition, definitely. And it's there's a lot of youngsters that are knocking behind me, and I cannot be.
They can knock behind you, but they can't knock you down.
They're also like probably behind, in front at the same time. But I'm trying to fight myself to be.
So you could still be there.
Yeah, I can, but.
Love
it. Hashtag MSW live now on 947 Vuma FM, Rise FM, and Soweto Live at the same time. Hashtag MSW.